intimations this evening, friends, as follows. We welcome all to the evening service, those present with us and those joining with us online. The service is next Lord's Day, the usual times of 12 noon and 6:30 here in Port Mahomack. Preacher expected is Mr. Donald Robertson. Midweek meeting on Wednesday at 7:30 p.m. via Zoom. The latest edition of Trinitarian Bible Society's quarterly record is available free of charge on the table in the vestibule. And the Tarbert Congregation's annual gift week is now running. If the envelopes could be returned by the end of November, this would be greatly appreciated. All arrangements, the Lord willing. Now let us worship God, singing to his praise from Psalm 107. Psalm 107 from the beginning of the psalm. Praise God, for he is good, for still his mercies lasting be. Let God's redeemed say so, whom he from the enemies handed free, and gathered them out of the lands from north, south, east, and west. They strayed in desert's pathless way, no city found to rest. Singing verses 1 to 9 of Psalm 107, praise God, for he is good. us pray. O Lord, we come to thee on the evening of this thy day, desiring that thou wouldst abide with us. We come, O Lord, in that name that is above every name, the name of our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. We have nothing of ourselves, O Lord, no merits of our own to bring to thee. But we come, O Lord, looking unto Jesus, seeking access to thy throne of grace through Christ. We bless thee, O Lord, that he is the way, the truth, and the life, and confess that no man cometh unto the Father but by him. Gladly do we come by him, O Lord, to that throne of grace, that we might find mercy and grace to help us in time of need. We confess our own sinfulness, our own unworthiness to stand before thee. But thank thee, O Lord, that thou hast not left us to ourselves, but in thy great love and mercy hast opened up the way of salvation. We thank thee that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. He came that we might have life, and that we might have it more abundantly. We thank thee that he is the resurrection and the life, and that he that believeth in him, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Grant us, O Lord, we pray, each one, that spiritual and eternal life. Work in us by thy Holy Spirit, we pray thee, that each one of us might be born again, born from above, born of thy Holy Spirit. We pray that we might have that one thing that is needful. Forbid, O Lord, that we would go through this life and come to the end of it, having done many things but lacking the one thing that is needful. But may we have Christ for ourselves, the pearl of great price, and that we might be willing to give up all that we might have him, not having our own righteousness, which is as but filthy rags, but that we might be clothed in the righteousness of Christ and have that pure and spotless wedding garment, and so be ready to meet with thee and to pass, O Lord, from this world to that which is to come, when thou dost call us to do so. Help us, we pray, O Lord, to lay aside every sin, every weight, and the sin that doth so easily beset us, and to go in thy way, that we might live for thee and for thy glory, whilst here below, seeking first thy kingdom and thy righteousness, trusting thee to add all things needful unto us. We bless thee, O Lord, that ever thou didst sink upon us in thy loving kindness and in thy tender mercies. We pray thee, O Lord, tonight to draw us close to thyself, and to draw nigh to us in mercy, that we might be conscious of thy gracious presence, known and felt here in our midst tonight. Though we be but few in number, may we have thine own self with us. Bless, we pray thee, all gathered here, and those who listen in through other means. Meet with us all in mercy, we pray. Bless the congregation here and all associated with it, every individual, every family. Bless any who are laid aside at this time, unable to be with us. Lay thine healing hand upon them. Protect us, O Lord, in these days, we ask, and keep us. And above all, we pray that thou wouldst unite us all in the Lord Jesus, that we all might belong to him, safe in the arms of God. O Lord, have mercy upon us, we pray. Help us tonight to come and to sit at the feet of Christ, that we might learn of him. We thank thee that he is meek and lowly in heart and waiting to be gracious. O Lord, bless thy word wherever it goes forth tonight, we pray, north, south, east and west. Visit with thy salvation. And bless, we pray, thy cause amongst us, up and down the land. How we need thee, O Lord, in these spiritually barren and dark days. Oh, that thou wouldst rend the heavens and come down and visit us again in a day of thy power, we pray, that these long desolations might flourish again, O Lord, as in the days of old, and that many might be found coming under conviction of sin, coming to places like this, that the seats might be filled up with men and women, boys and girls, seeking for the bread of life. O Lord, all things are possible unto thee. We thank thee that nothing is too hard for thee. Grant us the faith to believe it, we pray. And may we persevere in seeking thee for the blessing. Bless thy beloved people throughout the land and to the ends of the earth, and those that suffer and are persecuted for righteousness' sake. Be with them, we pray thee, and deliver them from evil. Protect them and their families and children. We pray, O Lord, as we are bidden, for those that have the rule over us, those in authority. We pray that they might realise their responsibilities before thee, that thou in thy great sovereignty would so overrule, O Lord, that thou wouldst direct them in their thinking and in their decisions to do that which is right and pleasing in thy sight. We pray thee to give us not up to ourselves and to wickedness, but to turn us back, we pray thee, to thyself, and to thy word, and to thy ways. Thou wouldst grant days of repentance. Turn the heart of the people back, O Lord, we pray, to thyself, that we might seek thee whilst thou mayest be found. Help us to press on, we pray, through this wilderness journey. We pray thou wouldst keep us from all evil. We thank thee that thou art with thy people, and thou wilt never leave us nor forsake us. We pray that we might know thy help, O Lord, in all the experiences of life. Sanctify to us, we pray thee, the trials that thou dost give to us. May these things draw us closer to thyself. We pray thou wouldst be with us in the week that we are now entered upon. Help us, O Lord, each step of the way. Guide us and keep us. We know not what lies ahead, but we thank thee to be in thy hands. Help us to trust in thee with all our heart and to lean not unto our own understanding. In all our ways may we acknowledge thee, and do thou direct our paths. We thank thee for the blessing of the Lord's day, where we might come again to a right perspective on the things of life and death, of this world and eternity to come. We thank thee for thy precious word. Help us as we come to it, we pray. Thou wouldst open to us the scriptures, helping us to understand. And if there be any amongst us, or those who listen on, or as yet strangers to thy saving grace, we pray that their hearts might be opened to the Saviour by thy Holy Spirit, that they might see themselves as they are by nature, in sin and in a dangerous condition, and may they be enabled to look unto Jesus, the Saviour of sinners, the one who is offered to us in the Gospel. O Lord, help us to turn, we pray thee, from this world and to rest upon Christ and to feed upon him, the bread of life. Come to us tonight, O Lord, we pray. Grant us a touch from heaven. Work in us by thy Holy Spirit. Quicken us, we pray, O Lord. Grant us spiritual life and quickening from above. And these things we ask with the forgiveness of all our many sins, in Jesus' name. Amen. We sing again to God's praise, this time in Psalm 92. Psalm 92, from the beginning of the psalm. To render thanks unto the Lord, it is a comely thing. And to thy name, O thou most high, do praise aloud to sing. Thy loving kindness to show forth when shines the morning light, and to declare thy faithfulness with pleasure every night. Singing verses 1 through 4 of Psalm 92, to render thanks unto the Lord. Turn in the Word of God to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 8. Luke's Gospel, chapter 8, And we begin to read at verse 37. Luke 8 at verse 37. Then the whole multitude of the country of the Gadarenes round about besought him to depart from them, for they were taken with great fear. And he went up into the ship and returned back again. Now the man out of whom the devils were departed besought him that he might be with him. But Jesus sent him away, saying, Return to thine own house, and show how great things God hath done unto thee. And he went his way and published throughout the whole city how great things Jesus had done unto him. And it came to pass that, when Jesus was returned, the people gladly received him, for they were all waiting for him. And behold, there came a man named Jairus, and he was a ruler of the synagogue. And he fell down at Jesus' feet and besought him that he would come into his house. For he had one only daughter, about 12 years of age, and she lay a dying. But as he went, the people thronged him. And a woman having an issue of blood 12 years, which had spent all her living upon physicians, neither could be healed of any, came behind him and touched the border of his garment, and immediately her issue of blood staunched. And Jesus said, Who touched me? When all denied, Peter and they that were with him said, Master, the multitude throng thee and press thee, and sayest thou, Who touched me? And Jesus said, Somebody hath touched me, for I perceive that virtue is gone out of me. And when the woman saw that she was not hid, she came trembling and falling down before him. She declared unto him before all the people for what cause she had touched him, and how she was healed immediately. And he said unto her, Daughter, be of good comfort, thy faith hath made thee whole, go in peace. While he yet spake, there cometh one from the ruler of the synagogue's house, saying to him, Thy daughter is dead, trouble not the master. But when Jesus heard it, he answered him, saying, Fear not, believe only, and she shall be made whole. And when he came into the house, he suffered no man to go in save Peter and James and John, and the father and the mother of the maiden. And all wept and bewailed her. But he said, Weep not, she is not dead, but sleepeth. And they laughed him to scorn, knowing that she was dead. And he put them all out, and took her by the hand, and called, saying, Maid, arise. And her spirit came again, and she arose straightway, and he commanded to give her meat. And her parents were astonished, but he charged them that they should tell no man what was done. Amen. May the Lord be pleased to add his gracious blessing to the reading of his holy word. Let us sing again, this time in Psalm 40, 40, Psalm 40, from verse 12. For ills past reckoning compass me, and mine iniquities such hold upon me taken have, I cannot lift mine eyes. They more than hairs are on mine head, thence is my heart dismayed. Be pleased, Lord, to rescue me. Lord, hasten to mine aid. Singing verses 12 to the end of the psalm, of Psalm 40, for ills past reckoning compass me. If you'd turn with me this evening, friends, to the chapter from which we read, the Gospel of Luke, chapter 8. I'd like us to look at the portion we have, verses 43 to 48. Luke 8 at 43. And a woman having an issue of blood 12 years, which had spent all her living upon physicians, neither could be healed of any, came behind him and touched the border of his garment, and immediately her issue of blood staunched. And Jesus said, "Who touched me? Who touched me?" Now we have in these verses the account of the woman with the issue of blood. We're not given her name, but an account of her is recorded in the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke. The context here is that Jairus, a ruler of the synagogue, had come to beseech Jesus to come to his house to heal his daughter who was dying. And it is as Jesus journeyed to Jairus' house that this incident with the woman occurred. Praise God, there is always room for sinners, needy sinners, in the timetable of Jesus Christ. And so there was here. What can we say about this woman? I'd like us to notice three things. Firstly, she was a woman in need. A woman in need. She had this disease referred to here as an issue of blood. It presumably means she was prone to loss of blood, discharge of blood. Such, of course, is a very serious condition. I am no expert in medical things, but I suppose that blood loss can leave a person in weakness and potentially is very dangerous, even life-threatening condition. So it clearly would have affected this woman physically. This disease would also have affected this woman socially. It would have been a condition that was very inconvenient to live with. But more than that, this condition would have made the woman to be classed as ceremonially unclean. With respect to the Old Testament ceremonial laws that the people of Israel were to observe. You can read about this in Leviticus chapter 15. And being ceremonially unclean, she would have been barred from access to the temple and from spiritual privileges. She would have had to endure at least a degree of separation from the people, with all the loneliness and the potential embarrassment that would have brought with it. We're told that she had had this disease, that she had been afflicted with this condition for 12 years. This wasn't just a thing of the moment, a recent affliction. No, for 12 long, wearying, burdensome years, she had been in this position, with all the effect that it would have had upon her body and upon her life. It appears that she had been diligent in seeking a remedy for her condition. She had been to the physicians, the doctors, and the medics of her day, but found that none of them could heal her. Indeed, Mark in his gospel tells us that she was nothing bettered, but rather grew worse. And we're told that she had spent all her living upon physicians. No doubt they were happy to take her money. Mark says that she had spent all that she had. So she was impoverished physically, she was impoverished financially. And in so doing, she had only suffered the more. She was nothing bettered, but only grew worse. only the worse. What a sad case this woman seemed to be. But oh, my friends, do you not see here a clear picture of the condition of every sinner? A picture of your condition and mine, as we are by nature. By nature, we are all plagued with the disease of sin. And this disease has ruined us. It affects us physically, it affects us spiritually, it affects us in every faculty of our being. It makes us unclean, and it separates us from God. And what's more, we can never heal ourselves of this disease. And so as this woman sought to the physicians, so sinners seek to the physicians of this world for relief and for cure. They look to this one, and they look to that one, but they do not have the answers. You may seek to the pleasures of this world for relief, for happiness, for peace. You may spend all your living, even all that you have, on these things. But with respect to your disease of sin and getting healing from it, these things cannot help you. You are nothing bettered, but only the worse. Only the worse. Firstly, then, she was a woman in need. In need. Secondly, she was a woman who exercised faith. She was a woman who exercised faith. Mark, in his gospel, tells us that this woman, she had heard of Jesus. Exactly what she had heard, we are not told. Perhaps she had heard of his miracles, of his healing those in need, of his compassionate dealings with men. Whatever she had heard certainly seemed enough to encourage her to seek Christ for help. There was obviously a crowd of people with Jesus here. We are told that as he went, the people thronged him. Mark says that she came in the press, that is, in the crowd. We are told that she came behind Jesus. Her modesty, perhaps, would mean that she would not speak to Jesus openly about her disease, and she would not ask publicly for a cure, as others might. Being ceremonially unclean, she perhaps would not wish to make her presence known, but she obviously saw this as an opportunity to get close to Jesus without being noticed. She could be lost in the crowd. But she clearly came believing that Christ could help her. Believing that Christ could help her. That he could heal her. In Matthew's Gospel, we're told, she said within herself, "If I may but touch his garment, I shall be whole." And what is that? That is faith. Faith in Christ and in his power to heal. "I have suffered with this disease all these years. No one else could cure me of it. I only got worse. But I know that if I may but touch the hem of his garment, I shall be made whole." And so she put out her hand and touched the garment of the Son of God. She touched it in faith. In faith. Faith is the hand that reaches out and touches Christ. The empty hand outstretched to receive the blessing. She touched him in faith. And having touched Christ, we're told that immediately her issue of blood staunched. That is, it stopped, it ceased. Mark says, "Straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague." She was healed fully. She was healed immediately. What she had sought in vain for 12 long years was now done in a moment. The cure that many physicians could not give her was wrought in a moment when she came to the Saviour. When she came to the Saviour. This shows it was a miracle. Ordinarily, when we recover naturally from illness or disease, it takes a period of time, doesn't it? There is a period of convalescence, but not here. Here the cure was immediate. It was the powerful work of God. And I say again, dear friend, what a picture this woman is for us of how we need to be healed and made whole spiritually from the disease of sin. How we need to be saved from it and from its terrible effects. Surely the experience of many a person reflects the experience of this woman here. Many a person has spent sorrowful years in search of peace, in search of satisfaction, but has not found it. They have sought it in what the world offers. They've sought it in earthly remedies, but they've found no relief. But at last, they came to Christ, seeking for peace, seeking for mercy. And there they found rest. There the burden fell from off their shoulders. My friend listening tonight, do you know this in your own experience? Do you know what it is to have been made whole? Have you come in faith to the Saviour, knowing that only He can help you? You may say, but faith is a gift of God. I know it is, but God is willing to give it to all that ask Him. It is our duty to come in faith to Christ. The crowd here was following Jesus. Many perhaps followed in curiosity to see His miracles or to hear what He said. How many, I wonder, followed Him in faith? But this poor woman did. She may have had this difficult condition. She may have been despised and written off by many. But she came in faith to Jesus, and she got the blessing. She got the blessing. Oh, my friend, have you come to the Saviour and received a blessing of salvation? So then this woman, she was a woman in need. She was a woman who exercised faith. And thirdly and lastly, I want us to notice, she was a woman brought to confess Christ before men. She was a woman brought to confess Christ before men. This woman, she had come secretly to Christ in the crowd. And having touched Him and been healed, we assume she just wanted to slip away unnoticed, as quietly as she had come. But Christ asks this question, "Who touched me?" Verse 45. And Jesus said, "Who touched me?" When all denied, Peter and they that were with him said, "Master, the multitude throng thee and press thee, and sayest thou, who touched me?" Lord, all this crowd and people pressing you all around, why do you ask, who touched me? But Jesus said, "Somebody hath touched me." That is, somebody has touched me by faith. And that is the distinction, you see. Somebody has touched me by faith. Yes, many people are crowding around, but somebody has touched me by faith. For I perceive that virtue is gone out of me. Virtue here means power. It was not, of course, that Christ did not know who had touched him. He knew it was the woman. He knew her name. He knew her case, her history. He knew everything about her. Why then did he ask the question? It was not for his benefit, but for the benefit of others. He certainly didn't draw attention to the woman to censure her in any way. No, no, on the contrary. When she was identified, Christ encouraged her and commended her before others. But it is appropriate, do you see, for Christians to confess Christ before men, to confess the benefits and the blessing of salvation that we have received from him. And that surely was what Christ would teach this woman and any others who would take note of it. Verse 47. When the woman saw that she was not hid, she came trembling and falling down before him. She declared unto him before all the people for what cause she had touched him, and how she was healed immediately. I find that verse very, very solemn in the next chapter of this gospel, Luke 9 and 26, where Christ says, "For whosoever shall be ashamed of me and of my words, of him shall the Son of Man be ashamed, when he shall come in his own glory and in his Father's and of the holy angels." Oh, let us not be afraid or ashamed to confess Christ before men, to tell them plainly what he has done for our souls. May we be willing to acknowledge Christ as our Master, whatever ridicule or the like it may bring to us. So this woman, she was unable to confess before men to the glory of Christ what he had done for her. And Christ encourages this woman. He says, "Daughter, be of good comfort." She had come trembling and falling down before him, fearing perhaps that she would be censured for having come secretly. No, Christ comforts her and he fills her heart with gladness. She had good reason to be of good comfort now. Her body was healed, her soul was saved. Christ commends her for her faith. "Thy faith hath made thee whole. Go in peace." Faith brings honour to Christ. And Christ here honours faith. There may be true faith where yet there is trembling. May be true faith where yet there is trembling. As we draw to a close, let me ask you, dear friend, have you touched Christ by faith? Christ comes to us tonight in his word, and he says, "Who touched me?" I say, have you touched him? Touched him by faith? If we are to be saved, there must be for each one of us the personal touch, the personal faith in Christ. This woman here, she heard of Jesus and she sought for him. She had the opportunity, hidden in the crowd, to come to him. She took the opportunity, not knowing if or when she would ever have another opportunity. She knew she must get to Christ while she could. You are found, dear friend, under the gospel tonight, with the opportunity of coming to the Saviour, not knowing how long your time of opportunity will last. And so I urge you to come to Christ and to touch him tonight, to touch him by faith. Maybe you've been laboring under the burden of sin for many long years. Maybe you've sought in various ways to the physicians, as it were, of this world. Have you come to see that all the physicians of this world, all of them put together, with all of the remedies that this world supposes to offer to you, they cannot cure you of your disease of sin? With them, you will only get the worse, only the worse. Have you come, as this poor woman did, to Christ, believing that only he can cure you, that only he can save you, believing that if I may but touch the hem of his garment, I shall be made whole? Christ is the great physician, the great physician of souls. And he is willing and able to save all who come unto him. And that includes you, my friend. That includes you. Faith is the hand, the empty hand that stretches out to touch Christ and to receive the gift. Oh, my friend, put out your hand, as it were, tonight. Put out your hand and touch Christ by faith and receive the blessing of salvation. Be made whole, spiritually whole, and go in peace. Christ comes then in his word tonight, and he asks, who touched me? Who touched me? I ask you, my friend, was it you? Amen. Our final singing this evening is from Psalm 66 at verse 13. Psalm 66 at 13. I'll bring burnt offerings to thy house, to thee my vows I'll pay, which my lips uttered, my mouth spake, when trouble on me lay. Down to the end of the psalm, O let the Lord, our gracious God, forever blessed be, who turned not my prayer from him, nor yet his grace from me. Psalm 66, 13 to the end, I'll bring burnt offerings to thy house. Let us close with prayer. O Lord, we thank thee for the grace of Christ to needy sinners, that he is willing and able to save every one of us. Help us, O Lord, to put out the hand of faith, to touch Christ and to receive the gift of salvation, that we might be made whole, that we might go in peace. Have mercy upon us, everyone, O Lord, we pray. Forgive our sins and part us with thy gracious blessing. For Jesus' sake, amen.